welcome to service today. So good to see you on Daylight Saving Day. And I'm glad you set your clocks ahead. I'm the kind of guy who set my clock ahead and stay up all night worried about it. So I don't know, but we're here looking forward to a great blessing. Find, if you would, page 213. 213. Let's bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. Let's stand. Lift your voice now. 213.
Father, we thank you so much for this morning, for just the privilege that we have to come together. Thank you, Lord, for your word and that it applies to every single aspect of our lives. Lord, may you find this morning people that have ready ears and open hearts and certainly minds that are willing to be transformed by the renewing of your word in our lives. Father, may that be the power that changes our lives. May we be consecrated unto you. May we search after you, and that your word would apply in every aspect that needs to be changed in our lives. Lord, I pray that you would fill Pastor with your spirit, that his words would be clear unto us, and that, Father, that you would speak through him to challenge us and allow us to be useful tools for the kingdom of God. Lord, we love you and we thank you. It is in your son's precious name that we pray. Amen. Please turn around and greet one another.
See you this Sunday morning. Welcome to Plantation Baptist Church. It is our joy and our hope that you're part of the family of God, born into his family by the blessed Lord Jesus, and excited to be in his house today. If you're visiting with us, there should be a card in the pew in front of you. If you'd be so kind, if you've never filled one of those out, to please do so and put it in the offering plate when it goes by. That'll give us a record of your visit, maybe who invited you, how you heard about us. All of those things are a blessing, and we look forward to receiving that information. While they're doing that, let me make some announcements. Don't forget about our service tonight at 6 o'clock. We have two specials tonight. We have a missionary that will be with us, and then Brother Bill Neely Sr. will be preaching to us tonight, and I know that you'll be blessed, and look forward to that time. Our service will be at 6. For those of you that have not been able to drive at night because you have a hard time seeing, it should be daylight when you go home. And if it's not, if he hasn't stopped preaching by 7 o'clock, just go home anyway. That's what you do to me. You make it there and you'll have no No problem whatsoever. Important things that are in the bulletin as well. Announcement about our school and the early registration. This coming Saturday, we have a very special time for our teachers. If you are a full-time or substitute teacher, in the bulletin it says Sunday school or junior church. I forgot about Wednesday night in Awana or with the youth department. We're having a time of training on Saturday from 9 till noon. Brother Ruben Nunez, Brother Keith Scheffler, Mrs. Kim Smith will be involved in that and some others. And I know that it will be a blessing to help sharpen our skills there. And so I would encourage you to make it. If you can't make it for all, get what you can. But I've seen the material, and I know that you're going to be encouraged. And we can all use some help as teachers in this area. A lot of upcoming events that are in the bulletin as well. Next Sunday night is Palm Sunday. And then we have Easter on March 27th. Don't forget, we have the cards that are in the bulletin to be handed out. I'm asking you to invite somebody to Easter service. I'm asking every family to bring a family, every person to try to bring somebody on Easter Sunday. Easter Sunday, we have 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock will be our two services. No Sunday school and no evening service. And so how many have already invited somebody to Easter service? Can I see your hand? Great. The rest of us need to catch up. Pastor, I don't know anybody. Well, you must be the meanest person on the earth. That's all I know. Pray and ask the Lord. Lord, open up an opportunity for me to invite somebody to Easter service, and I give them a chance to hear the gospel. Wanted to say about Wednesday nights. Now we have our Bible study on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Don't forget the meal time before that. In the bulletin, it says that we're going to have bourbon chicken on Wednesday night. I just feel like I need to say something about bourbon chicken in a Baptist church. Did you know there's no bourbon in bourbon chicken? Tell me you knew that. And so you look it up. There'll be no bourbon. It's called bourbon chicken because it was first passed out on Bourbon Street there in Louisiana. And so, Pastor, there's bourbon in my chicken. Well, there's not going to be bourbon in our chicken, but it tastes really good. And so I'd encourage you to eat with us on Wednesday nights and be a blessing. Man, the choir did a fantastic job at 8:30. They're singing a song about faith. They're singing a song about walking not by sight, but by faith. It blessed my soul, and I believe it'll bless yours. God bless you, choir, as you sing.
Lives of those who prove his faithfulness.
wonderful job, choir. What a great truth to walk by faith and not by sight. You talk about the joy of living. Stirred our souls. Marvelous job. Page number 562 is our opportunity to sing about our walk. The great anthem of the church. Song that has been, sung throughout the ages. The hymn writer wrote a great one when he wrote, "Be thou my vision, O Lord, of my heart." Talks about the edification of Christ in our eyes and the exaltation captivated from that verse in the book of Philippians that says, whatever was to my benefit, I count but loss for the sake of Christ. Powerful and wonderful song. Let's stand. Let's lift our voice. Let's sing about our great vision, the Lord Jesus Christ. Job. Let's dismiss our children up through the fifth grade to junior church. If you have a child you're visiting with us up through the fifth grade, you could let them go. They'll enjoy the class. You could walk them out and come back however you want to work that. Men, if you'll wait on us for our offering, we'll have our prayers of the people. We'll have our offertory sung by Miss Morgan Hansen. I know you're going to be blessed. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father God, thank you for music, Lord. Thank you for music that's written and founded upon the Word of God, music that stirs our hearts to the truth and the security of God's Word. And Lord, it was our desire and is our desire to come into the house of God bringing the sacrifice of praise. We're told that in the Word of God that it would come forth from our lips. The Bible said, everything that hath breath, let it praise the Lord. If anybody ought to praise the Lord, it ought to be the people of God. And so we bring you praise today, and we bring you glory for who you are, the true and living God. And then God, to listen to the choir sing about our walk by faith and not by sight, and just to know the thrill of that walk and the reality of that in our lives. And you could just see in their face the joy of what they were singing. You could sense in your spirit the power of that great song. And I pray today, God, as we leave, that we will leave walking by faith, not by our sight. How fitting for the message today as well. And then, God, that great anthem that's been sung throughout the history of the church, "Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart." Wonderful thoughts in that song. that you would be first in our heart, that you'd be the treasure of our life, that we would reckon you to be the ruler of all. And so, God, I pray today that Christ would be found to be preeminent in our heart and our mind. And as we follow you, Lord, we would follow you in complete and total obedience by faith. What a joy. Thank you for our church. Thank you for what you're doing in the life of our church. Thank you for the two souls that were saved this week. And God, the answers to prayer. And we're standing in the gap for many. Miriam Siciliano would be one. I pray you'd just minister to her today. God, I see others that are here that were in the hospital this week and some that will be going in the hospital. And what a joy it is just to trust the great physician as the great shepherd of our life. Meet every need that's here today. If there anybody be lost today, God, please lead them to the cross where they can find the Savior and the salvation of their soul. We love you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. May be seated. So we bring the tithe and give the offering. May it be a time of worship for you. Listen to our offertory. Thank you, Morgan. If you've been led to the cross, say amen. Sure love Morgan, proud of her, proud of what God is doing in her life. Had the wonderful privilege to sit and talk with her a few moments a couple of weeks ago, and she shared with me how that God was moving in her heart and her life. That song came from her heart and what God is doing, and just blessed my soul immensely. If you have your Bibles, find, if you would please, the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is located in about the middle of your Bible. It would be after the book of Proverbs. If you get into books like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Lamentations, you've gone too far. And we began a series in this book last week. And I cannot tell you how excited I am to be able to preach to you this series and preach to you what God has laid upon my heart in this book. I believe it to be tremendously practical, tremendously relevant for the time in which we live in. And I'm asking God to do a great work in our heart and through this book. And I'm asking Him to strengthen us and stable us and bring us to a position where we as believers fall down upon our knees and walk and trust Him, and where those that do not know the Lord would come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. I entitled this series, When Worlds Collide. When Worlds Collide. I think it's a very fitting title for this book, because really and truthfully, this book is about an experiment that Solomon did with two worlds. Solomon, I believe to be the author of this book. You might recognize his name if you're a Bible student. You know that Solomon, according to verse number 1 of the first chapter, was the son of David. You know that Bathsheba is his mother. You understand that Solomon followed David as king of Israel. Some things about Solomon that you know as well is that in his early days, Solomon was blessed of the Lord. In his early days, Solomon walked with the Lord in a powerful and wonderful way, where God's power was manifested visibly multiple times. God used him to build the temple for the nation of Israel. You understand that when that temple was finished, Solomon stood outside that temple and he fell on his knees and he prayed, and the glory of God filled that temple so thick that no one could go in. Solomon was so blessed of the Lord that God met him and said, Solomon, what can I do to help you? What can I do to be a blessing? Solomon, what would you want? You know that Solomon's request was for wisdom. He knew himself to be a young man. He knew himself to have a tremendous responsibility in leading this nation. And so he wanted the wisdom of God and God's help. By the way, wisdom is still a good desire today. One of the ways to check yourself as to where you stand is, how many times this past week did you ask God for wisdom? Wisdom. The Bible said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask who? God. And so you find yourself asking God for wisdom throughout the week. That's a good self-checker right there. Pastor, I didn't ask God for wisdom this week. Then I would dare say you probably had a week that was not what it should have been or could have been as you asked God for wisdom in directing your life. Solomon asked for wisdom. God not only gave him wisdom, God gave him wealth. God enlarged Solomon more than he had ever dreamed. And God used Solomon to expand the kingdom. And as Solomon is expanding the kingdom and the nation is being blessed, God's hand was on him. The problem with Solomon was his pride got in the way. And instead of him allowing God to exalt him, Solomon began to exalt himself. I want to give you another caution here. Be careful about exalting yourself. It's okay to have a desire to be promoted at work. It's okay to have a desire to be enlarged. It's okay to have a desire to get education or to kind of prepare yourself. It's just not okay to position yourself. I'm going to come at this a little bit carefully. The Bible says to the believer, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due season. If you're going to be exalted, you want God to exalt you. Many people try to position themselves and manipulate their life. And you understand this. This is not just God promoting you. This is you thinking and you having a drive for exaltation in something. Be careful about that. We're not designed to exalt ourselves. Self-exaltation is not trustworthy. If you're going to be exalted in your life, you want it to be because you humbled yourself to the hand of God. Amen? So Solomon stopped humbling himself. He began to do some things. Number one, he began to gather to himself horses out of Egypt. He was told not to do that. He began to gather himself with wine and silver and so on. He was told not to do that. He began to gather women and wives. He was told not to do that. But in his pride, he began to do that. And what happened was that as those things were coming, his heart began to be turned away from the Lord. Not that he was not a believer in the Lord, not that Solomon's not in heaven today, but that walk was turned. And so Solomon had a point, a part in his life where he was not walking closely to the Lord. And he did eternal damage in those days and in those months. In the midst of that, Solomon went on an experiment, what we're reading about in the book of Ecclesiastes. Now, I don't believe he ended his life that way. I believe that he did repent, and the book of Ecclesiastes is him writing in retro what he had went through. And so here's what Solomon did, the wisest man, the wealthiest man, the man blessed of the Lord. He began to try to find the meaning of life, and he began to try to find the meaning of life by looking at life from what we'll call a human perspective. He refers to it as under the sun. That phrase in Ecclesiastes, under the sun, means a perspective without God. And so here's what Solomon tried to do. He tried to determine, is life worth living without God? And not only did he just give the old college try, he invested his imagination. His wisdom surpassed anyone. He had the wealth to back or finance any plan that he had. He had sole supreme authority. Nobody was in his way or buffeting this man from investing himself in this experiment. So what had happened was, as his heart was turned away from a humble position with the Lord into a position of pride, Solomon tried to find meaning to life apart from the Lord, from a human perspective. When you come to chapter 1 and you come to verse number 2, he immediately gives us his deduction. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. What profit, what gain hath a man of all his labor which he taketh? Finish that verse, if you would please, under the sun. And so Solomon's experiment was to find profit in life under the sun, to determine, is life really worth living from a human perspective? And Solomon, well, as we go through this experiment, you're going to find that he comes at this experiment from multiple avenues. And the first avenue he comes through it with is kind of a scientific attitude. And he comes at it from a earthly mindset. And really and truthfully, he comes at this mindset scientifically, and it really deals with in verses 4-7, and we'll read those. He says, one generation passeth away, and another generation cometh, but the earth abideth how long, class? The sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hasteth to his place where he arose. Okay, so you have one generation going, one generation coming. You have the sun going, look at me, down, and coming up. Okay, look if you would at verse number 6. The wind goeth toward the south, and turneth about unto the north. So look at your pastor, to the south, and then it turns to the north. Read the verse. And it whirleth, I didn't even know whirleth was in the Bible, Pastor. It whirleth about how? So it goes south, north, continually. South, north, continually. It just whirls around. And the wind returneth again according to his circuits or its currents. All the rivers run into the sea. Yet the sea is not what? Full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, they return again. And so Solomon is, he's looking at life from a scientific view, and he sees one generation passes, another generation comes. He sees that the sun rises and the sun sets continually. He understands that the wind whirls around continually. He says the seas with the evaporation and the moisture, they run into the rivers run into the sea, and the sea is not full, and then the rivers run back to where they were from. And if you notice my finger in my circle that I'm making, really and truthfully, Solomon looks at life from a scientific view, which we could describe as the circle of life. Now, I thought what we would do at this point is all of us would sing that song from the Disney movie, The Circle of Life. Okay, how many know what I'm talking about? You've seen The Lion King. Okay, but I want you to understand something. That movie is based off of a philosophy that is in our world and prevalent today. And that prevalent philosophy really is the circle of life. And you would be amazed at how many people are living under the philosophy of the circle of life. And so the evidence of that would be some phrases that we use in our society. Everybody knows the song, The Circle of Life. Sometimes you will hear people say, life comes full circle. What goes around comes around, okay? So really and truthfully, there is a philosophy out there of the cycle or circle of life. This is the pattern or the philosophy that Solomon found himself noticing in the world. And he studied it immensely. And he was concentrated on it. And after his study, come to verse number 17. This is how he announced his findings. I gave my heart to know wisdom, to know madness and folly. And I perceived that this also is what, class? Vexation of spirit. So Solomon said, when it comes to the circle of life philosophy, it's a vexating philosophy. And really and truthfully, Solomon would say, if life is part of a cycle in which there is no control by you or even by God, if life is a cycle, then it's not worth living. Then it's not worth living. If life is a cycle, is life worth living? And so Solomon does this experiment. And he does this experiment, and he comes up with three conclusions. Let me give you the conclusions, and then I'll simplify this a little bit. I got to build a foundation here. He does this experiment, and he comes up with three conclusions. Write them down. Number one, nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. Number two, nothing is new. And number three, nothing is fully understood. Nothing has changed. Nothing is new. And nothing is fully understood. Now, as a scientist, Solomon looks at the earth, the sun, the wind, and the sea, and he makes this statement. He says, nothing changes. Verse number one, he says, generations passeth away, another generation is coming, but the earth abideth forever. Interesting that Solomon would say this. Now watch this, because this is the same philosophy we're battling today in our culture. This is the same philosophy that wants your vote. There's a word we should recognize. Okay? So Solomon, looking at the earth, the sun, the wind, and the sea. And all four of those seem to just be this monotonous, mundane circle. Every day, the sun comes up in the east, sets in the west. Every day, there's wind. Now, it may stir around, but it's the wind continually. Every day, the rivers are running into the sea, and the sea's not full. The rivers are returning back to where they were, and he just sees this massive circle of life. And by the way, I'll prove to you this is a philosophy that we're living in today, because there is a drive in our culture to save the planet. Some of you celebrate Earth Day. Some of you celebrate Save the Planet. And our culture is moving, and they've got everybody thinking that it's your responsibility to do your job to save the earth. Well, I got news for you. The Bible says that the earth abideth forever. Psalm 104, verse 5. Psalm 119, verse 90. Both of these psalms declare that the earth abides forever. News flash, the earth does not need you to save it. God promised that the earth would abide forever. Well, Pastor, the Bible says there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. Right. This earth will be renovated by fire, but there's not going to be this explosion of this earth and a new earth created. That would break God's word. And so we have this philosophy now that tells you that to protect the circle of life, you must do your part while you are alive. Solomon said, I understand from a human perspective that there's a circle to life, but he said in verse number 4 that the earth is permanent, but man is temporary. And the earth will abide forever. But what an audacious fool to think that you're going to live forever. Think about our world. Our world says, While you spend 70 years here, you better take care and save the earth. No, my friend, while you live here, you better take care and make sure your soul is saved. That's a whole philosophy they have. It's like they think man is going to live forever. And Solomon said, man, one generation cometh and another generation passeth away. And we're so focused on the earth, but the earth abides forever. It's man that is transient. And so we've got this philosophy to take care of the earth that denies that God even created it, that the earth somehow evolved. And if God didn't create it and it just evolved, then man, you have to take care of it. That's against God's word. God is able to take care of what he creates. So you have a circle of philosophy. No, my friend, it's not your job to save the earth. You need to be saved from your sin. And if you're saved, say amen. Solomon said, nothing has changed in the earth. Nothing has changed in the sun or the wind or in the sea. No wonder, as a scientist, from a human perspective, Solomon, looking at the circle of life and the mundaneness of every day, he's vexed in his spirit. And so what the circle of life philosophy will tell you is that you and I live in some closed, cruel system, like a wheel that a mouse would run, and there's no escape and there's no interruption. So just do your part in the circle of life. But I got news for you. That is a human perspective under the sun. A heavenly perspective says that my God is not limited to some circle of life. Our God created life, and our God is not limited in his power. Our God is not without the ability to interject himself into nature or into creation that he has done. And so our mindset is, well, I'm just here going around until I come around. And I'm just waiting for life to come full circle, and I'm kind of just let to go like this. No, my friend, we serve an all-powerful God who has a plan for your life. We serve an all-powerful God that has power over creation. You could read in that Bible where he stopped the sun so Joshua could finish a battle, where he moved the sun back for King Hezekiah, where he opened up the Red Sea. He turned off the rain for Elijah. He turned it on again. He calmed the wind and the seas. Listen, don't worship in the circle of life. Worship the life giver, Jesus Christ. Christian, when you got saved, God became your heavenly Father. You don't live in some closed system of life. Punch in on Monday. I punch out on Monday. I go to work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. I go out to dinner on Friday. I cut the grass on Saturday. I go to church and a nap on Sunday. Some of you work that together. I come back over here. I work my 46 weeks. I go on vacation. And you've just bought in that that's your life. Do not let the world's philosophy bring you to a prison of the circle of life. My friend, when you submit your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, he's got plans for your life. And Solomon said, this mundane circle from a human, why live? Nothing has changed. Then Solomon said in verses 8 to 11, it goes without saying, if nothing has changed, then there's nothing new. Look, if you would, at verse number 8. Powerful. All things are full of labor. Man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with what, class? Hearing. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing where? Under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. There is no remembrance of former things, neither shall there be any remembrance of things that are to come with those that shall come after. And so Solomon says, now listen, if you want to look at life from a human perspective, I can understand how you would think that life is just some circle that just runs itself and you're just caught up in this prison of the circle of life. He said, but when you step back from a heavenly vantage point, you will understand that that's not true. When you look into the past, it's the same. So if nothing has changed, then there cannot be anything new. Well, Pastor, that's ludicrous because I've got a new iPhone. So what do you mean there's nothing new? Do you know that there may be some creativity and there may be some certain things that will happen, but that new iPhone still does what the old phone with a cord does? It makes a call and it receives a call, right? But mine emails, right? You send a letter from here electronically around the world. We used to do that by ships. Not we, some of you, when you live back there, not me. But Pastor, I can go to Siri and I can get directions into the world. Yeah, we used to get that from our wife. That iPhone does nothing new. People have been communicating around the world forever. People have been banking forever. People have been bartering and paying just so you can do it electronically. You think that's new? That's not new. Listen to what Thomas Edison said about his inventions. Thomas Edison, and I quote, he said that my inventions were only bringing out the secrets of nature and applying them for the happiness of mankind. So Thomas Edison said, I didn't create anything. I took the secrets of nature. By the way, there's no such thing as Mother Nature. No Bible-believing, born-again Christian can celebrate, worship, or identify Mother Nature. If you declare there to be a mother nature, then you defy a holy God. Can't do it. And Edison said, I didn't create anything. He made the light. He said, all I did was I reached into nature, which God said, let there be. Okay. And he said, I took the secrets of nature and I unfolded them for the happiness of mankind. Now, I'm happy we have the light. But Edison said, do you think I created that new? Solomon, in all of his wisdom and all of his money, was searching. He bought every iPhone available back then. And he said, there's nothing new under the sun. But he noticed something, verse number 8. He noticed that the eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. And Solomon said, the drive for man to want something new. Is that you? Is that you? Do you have to have something new all the time? Nothing wrong with something new. Nothing wrong with buying a new car or something, buying something new or getting something new. But you understand what I'm talking about, those of you that have to have something new to feel good about yourself. And unless you have something new, you're bored out of your mind. There is a unsatisfied ability with the eye to see. It's never satisfied. And the ear is never full of hearing. And man has a drive to want something new. Apple understands this, so they feed it to us like little pets. And so you get your little pop tent, and you go down to Best Buy 3 months before the iPhone 7 comes out, and you sit by the door because you want something new. And so they piece it to you. And our society consumes it by the billions. Why? Because it's a distraction. Anything to take away the reality of their life. And the reality is, in verses 9 and 10, Solomon said, the world has nothing new to offer you. And so in his human perspective, in his desire to find life apart from God, Solomon said, man, I've tried everything. And in reality, the world has nothing else to offer. Well, I got news for you. The world may not have anything to offer you new, but God has something to offer you new. And God can create you new. And God can give you newness of life. And God can put a new song in your heart. And God can give you a new name written down in glory. And God can give you a new nature. He can give you new thoughts. He can give you new mercies. He can give you a new family. He can give you new friends. My friend, the only person who can do anything new in your life is God. And he does a pretty good job. So the mindset that finds vexation in the mundane circle of your life, they realize that every day is the same pretty much. And to cover that distraction or that hole in their life, they search for something new. It's dangerous. In his experiment, he came up with a third one, and he said this in verses 12 to 18. Not only has nothing changed, not only is there not anything new, nothing is fully understood. Now, I want you to follow me with this because there's some important and wonderful truths here. Nothing is fully understood. And so when you come to verse number 12, he says, I, the preacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem. I gave my heart to seek and search out by wisdom concerning all things that are done under heaven. This sore travail or grievous task hath God given to the sons of men to be exercised therewith or be disturbed with, trying to find out wisdom under the heaven. I have seen all the works that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity in what class? Vexation of spirit. That which is crooked cannot be made straight, and that which is wanting cannot be numbered. I communed with mine own heart, saying, lo, I am come to great estate. I've gotten more wisdom than all they that have been before me in Jerusalem. Yea, my heart had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. I gave my heart to know wisdom, to know madness and folly. And I perceived that it was vexation of spirit. For in much wisdom is much what? Grief. It's talking about human wisdom here. And he that increaseth knowledge increaseth sorrow. So Solomon looked at life from a human perspective and he said, nothing has changed in life. He looked at everything available to him and he said, there's nothing new under the sun. And then he looked at the reality of his life and he said, really, I can't even understand life fully. Now remember, don't lose me. This is from a human perspective. From a human perspective, the circle of life makes me dizzy. From a human perspective, I get bored real easy. And in reality, go buy you a new car, it drives just like every other car. Get you your iPhone 10, it'll do pretty much what your iPhone 1 did. It will do exactly what your flip phone did, make a call. And all the old men said, amen, Pastor. And then from human perspective, he said, you know, from my vantage point as a man, I don't fully understand life. Now, this is powerful here. And he goes in verses 13, 14, 15, and he gives us some conclusions about life. And in verse number 13, this is the conclusion. Life is tough. If you agree life is tough, say amen. When you look at life from a human perspective, I don't know how we make it. When you look at life from a human perspective, I understand why you do drugs. When you look at life from a human perspective, I can understand how a man would cheat on his wife. When you look at life from a human perspective, I understand why people are killing themselves crazy. Because if you strip God out of your perspective, life is tough. By the way, life is tough with God. And there's no escaping that. From a human perspective, life is tough, but from a heavenly perspective, life is a gift from God. Understand, when God created life in the garden, and he created life that knew no sin, it was sin that brought a toughness to our life. It was sin that made all of creation groan and labor with pangs. One of the reasons why life is so difficult is because there is sin. And if all you do is able to understand humanly, and you look at life with its injustices and its unfairness and its cruelty and its mistreatment, and you don't factor in that sin, then you don't understand how life got where it was. Because when God created life, he created it perfectly. Our world's not in trouble because of God. Our world's in trouble because of sin. Our world's not fighting AIDS and disease and STDs because of God. They're fighting because of their sin. Our world's not in poverty because of God. They're just in poverty because of sin. Our world's not strung out because of God. It's because of our own choices. And humanly perspective, man has the audacity to say, it's your fault, you whatever God. That's a human perspective. Our God's a God of love. Our God's all powerful. Our God gave his son for you. Yes, life is tough. It's not God's fault. Hallelujah. God intervenes into our life and brings his peace and his joy. Life is tough, but it's a gift. Verse number 14, Solomon says in his worldly wisdom, life doesn't get any easier. That's what he's saying. I've seen all the works that are done under the sun. And behold, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Pastor, I'm just waiting for my life to get simpler. Good luck, Chuck. That's in the book of Hezekiah. You'll find it there. Pastor, I'm just waiting for things to get easy and simplify. I'm waiting for my ship to come around. Right. You live under the philosophy of the circle of life. One day it's going to be my turn. I want to introduce you to someone. His name is Jesus. He's always your turn. Good turn. We call them holics. Name me a holic. What do we call them? What kind of holics do we have? Alcoholic. Workaholic. Shopaholic. I heard that. You know what a holic is? A holic is somebody who's looking at life with a human perspective. And you see that life is not going to get any easier. So they run away from reality and they try to live on substitutes. They run away from reality and they live on substitutes. Is that you? I'm asking you point blank, man. Solomon just puts it right where we live. Are you trying to escape your reality? Are you living on the substitute of your lives? Pastor, I just can't stop. If I stop and I think about all my problems, I'm in trouble. As long as I stay focused, as long as I keep moving, and so I go from one thing to another thing, from one thing to another thing, and as long as I can, I'm just doing whatever I can to escape my reality. And so basically we live on substitutes. Listen, from a human perspective, you can do that, but I promise you one day your substitute bubble is going to burst. So when I say bubble burst, when in our culture, in our world today, when we talk about the bubble bursting, we talk about what market? Come on, stock or the housing market. And so all of those people that went into the housing market trying to escape their reality, they wanted to live their life in a different substance. And so when money became something they could get, they didn't just walk to it, man. They ran to it. They didn't take a bite out of it. They plunged in head first, and they sucked up everything they could. And so the society was making concessions, and so people were buying things that they could not afford. People were living lives they could not afford. Money was everywhere. And when money becomes everywhere, the real you comes out. And so our world, wanting to escape reality, rushed into this life, and that bubble went, and then it went boom. And the bankruptcies and the hurt and the loss was immense. That's what's going to happen to you. If you try to escape your reality with another substance, you're building a bubble that will burst. It only makes life harder when we try to escape. The human perspective says run away. The heavenly perspective says instead of running away from life, we should run to God. And when you run to God, life is worth the living. Amen. Solomon said, life is tough. Life doesn't get easier. I love verse number 15, and this is where I'll close today. They put that big clock up there in the back to help me. Did you see that? It's ticking down good. Actually, that was my idea. That was a human perspective idea right there. I'll tell you that for sure. Okay. So if you sit there and think, does he know what time it is? Come on. Staring me in the face. Verse 15. That which is what? Crooked cannot be made what? And that which is wanting cannot be made what? Numbered. Solomon said, now, in my human perspective, things can't change. Not everything can be changed. Basically, what Solomon was saying is the past can't always be changed. And it is foolish to fret over spilt milk. Solomon is saying if we spend all of our time and energy trying to straighten out everything that is twisted in our life, we'll have nothing left. So from your human perspective, when you look at your past, if that past is twisted up, the reality is you can't change your past. That's right. Now, I want to be tender here, but I want to be powerful here. Some of you, your future is not worth living because you're dwelling in your past. And you have let the crookedness of your past twist you up so bad that anything you can do to get relief from that reality, you will chase and it has sucked every hope of the future out of your life. And so you're just waiting for what goes around to come around. Humanly speaking, we cannot change the past. But heavenly speaking, hallelujah, the past of our lives can be made straight in the blood of Jesus Christ. So what do you do with a crooked past? Well, you put it under the blood, you let the Lord cleanse it, and you let the Lord direct you to the future. Even God can't do anything about your past. God can't change your stupid decision, and he can't change my stupid decision. Do you think that I have a perfect past? I would to God I could take some of my past back. Do you think the devil don't beat me up sometimes with my past? I would to God I didn't have that. But I can't change the past. Neither can you. So get under it. No, Pastor, get over it. No, why would you be so foolish? Stop trying to get over your past and get under it with the blood of Jesus Christ. Let God forgive you, cleanse you. Yeah, there's consequences to that past. But God can take and so do a work that that past will not bother you in the future. Why would you live in the circle of life waiting for that past to come around? Let God free you from that. The child of God does not need to be a prisoner to their past. Amen. What are you doing? You'll be so vexated in your spirit. No wonder you can't get up. No wonder you got no drive. No wonder you can't. You let that thing twist you. Solomon said, man, I did everything I could try to do to change my past. I just realized can't change my past, but God can change the effect of your past on your tomorrow. Amen. Listen, we serve a wonderful God. He loves you. He doesn't want you to ride the circle of life. He wants you to find life in him. He wants you to be in him and know the abundance of life. He doesn't want you to think, oh, nothing can ever be changed, or nothing has changed. I understand that. But you don't have to live in the mundaneness of life. He's got a plan for you. There's nothing new. God can do new things in your life. And you say, well, Pastor, it's so hard, I can't figure it out. Right. Just trust the Lord with your life. He's trustworthy. Right. Amen? Amen? Powerful emotion, powerful thought process that Solomon went through. Verse 18, I'll close. For in much wisdom is much, say it, grief. Now, he's not talking about God's wisdom. He's talking about wisdom under the sun that's without God's book. But when you have the wisdom of God, my friend, it's not grievous, it's glorious. Put your life in that position. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father God, a scientific experiment that vexated Solomon's soul. He had three conclusions. Nothing's changed. There's nothing new. Nothing's fully understood. Therefore, it's all vanity. That's a human perspective. What a sorry place to live. Instead, we can live in the life of Christ, who has the power to interrupt the mundaneness of our lives and the nature of our lives and do wonderful and glorious things in and through us. He hears my prayer. He answers my prayer. He does miracles. Nothing new, Solomon? Nothing new? Why don't you let me introduce you to the new mercy of God? Let me introduce you to the new name that we get, the new nature. Let me introduce you to the new family. Let me introduce you to new thoughts, new drives, new desires. Let me introduce you to the new freshness of a spirit-filled life. Yeah, the world has nothing new to offer. They're going to have iPhone 4 billion. It'll still do what we normally did. But there is newness available in Jesus Christ. And yeah, when you look at life from a human perspective, it's unfair, it's unjust, it makes no sense. It doesn't get easier, it's tough. But it's not a prison. When you look at life from a heavenly perspective, life is a gift, man. It's a gift. No, it doesn't get easier, but there's the peace of God that passeth all understanding. And when I don't understand life fully, I can trust God, for he understands perfectly. No reason for God's people to be vexated, Lord. It's a reason for us to have joy serving Christ. I wonder, with heads bowed and eyes closed, if I could just ask you a couple of questions. I want to ask the Christian a question. Are you vexated in your spirit by the circle of life? Have you been looking at life from that kind of philosophy? Have you been thinking, man, life is just tough? Life doesn't get any easier. Man, I can't do anything about this. Is that you? If so, I want you to know your God loves you. He's got a plan for you. He's got purpose for your life. And if you will surrender your life to him and let him have control and walk by faith, not by sight, oh, man, God will do great things in your life. Pastor, that's been me. I've been looking at life from that vantage point of under the sun. God convicted me today. I don't want to be there. I want to have life lived not under the sun, but over the sun in the Lord. And I want to serve him with all my heart. I want to let him have my life. If that's you, Christian, would you lift your hand? Let me see it. God speak to you today. Is that you? Wonderful. You can put him down. Maybe you're here today and you're not saved. Pastor, life is so tough to me. Right. You need the Lord. Pastor, life doesn't make sense. Right. You need the Lord. Pastor, my past. Right. You need the Lord. It all begins with being born again, not being religious, not doing the best you can. That'll vexate you, but being born again. I'm not a Christian, Pastor. I'm not saved, but I'd like to be. Don't embarrass me. Don't call my name, but pray for me, Pastor. I need to be born again. If that's you, would you lift your hand and let me pray for you? Pastor, I need to be saved. I see that hand in the back, sir. You can put it down. God bless you. Thank you. Anybody else? Pastor, pray for me today. Anybody? Okay. Heavenly Father, you've seen the hands. You know the hearts. The invitation is open. The altar will be open for people to come and have people pray with them. This man that raised his hand, he could come forward today, walk that long aisle, and just tell one of the men, I'd like to be saved. We'll take him to a private room right outside. Take a couple minutes, take a Bible, and show him how to be saved. God, Christians need to come and make sure their perspective is right. Not a human perspective, but a heavenly perspective. Not be in a position to be vexated, but in a position to walk by faith. Do that work in our lives. Many hands were raised. Give them courage to come forward and do business with you. Bless this invitation, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our song is page number 480. Let's stand. We usually have an invitation. This is the opportunity for you to come and to pray. And if you want somebody to pray with you, men are here, ladies are here. If you raise your hand that you'd like to be saved, if you'd have enough courage to walk this aisle, there'll be a man standing right here. Just say, I'd like to be saved. We'll take you to a room, take a Bible, show you how to be saved. The greatest day of your life. Christian, you lead the way. Maybe you got saved this week and you want to come and give testimony of that. You come now as we sing verse number one, Only Trust Him. Thank you. one more verse. I'm so excited to introduce to you today Will Joseph and Lene Fletcher. Marvelous young couple. God moved them from Pembroke Pines to God's country of Plantation and started coming to our church, started sitting and listening to the preaching and called and said, "Pastor, we'd like to come see." I had a wonderful privilege Friday for them to come in. We started talking and come to find out God had been stirring in them to be saved. And I had the privilege to lead them to the Lord in my office. We got on our knees together and they prayed to receive Christ as their Savior. If you rejoice with that, say amen. Isn't that wonderful? I rejoice with them as well. And so here's what I asked Will. I said, "Sir, tell me, when you listen to me preach, and I give that invitation where we stand up, I said, do you ever feel God say you should go forward?" And he's kind of a stoic kind of guy. He got this big cheesy grin on his face. And I said, "Gotcha." Because Tom doesn't matter. But if you're sitting out there and you feel God speak to you, that matters. That matters. He said, "Pastor, God's telling me I need to be saved." And they got saved. Was in new believers class and came forward today. How about you? You raised your hand. You want to be saved? We'll sing one more verse. This is for you. The men are here. You come as God leads you. This will be our last. Page number 584, yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. Brother Keith, make sure you have Will and Lene down here. Come forward, shake their hand, hug their neck, rejoice in them, what God has done in their heart. Come back tonight at 6 o'clock. Thank you for listening. So until then, God bless you.